understand data processing, one of the very important and essential parts of statistics. So in this section, we would understand how all data can be processed and why data processing is so important. So let's say you do a field survey and you collect a questionnaire data of 2,000, 20,000 people. Is it possible to actually understand and comprehend that data without doing data processing? Definitely it is a tedious job. So what we do is we apply certain types of mechanisms. Now, broadly defining, we can say data can be processed in the simplest form using three methods. Those are measures of central tendencies, measures of dispersion, and measures of relationship. When I say central tendency, it talks about the center of distribution. So at a point, what is the tendency to cluster is what is explained under measures of central tendency. So to keep it very simple, we have mean, mode, and median as the measures of central tendency. The next is measures of dispersion. Dispersion actually explains how far or how dispersed it is from the mean, and therefore it is known as measures of dispersion. Now this measure of dispersion can be understood under five basic criteria. Those could be through range, quartile deviation, mean deviation, standard deviation, and Lorentz curve. And finally, we understand the method of relationship. Now, relationship between two factors is understood through correlation. To cite a very simple example, I have a statement which says that there are lots of dark clouds, so there is high probability of rain. So what I am trying to do is, I am explaining a correlation between dark clouds and the possibility of rain. Now, again, note this correlation can be positive, where there can be a positive relation between the two. There can be a situation of no relation, and there can be a situation of negative relation that exists. So correlation varies from minus 1 to 0 to plus 1. Plus 1 shows a strong positive correlation, minus 1 shows a strong negative correlation, and 0 shows no correlation. Again, important to note, when you are using various statistical softwares, let's say SPSS, a statistical package for social sciences, which is one of the softwares that you use, this software has an ability to do correlation between even two undefined or unrelated variables. So let's say on one end I have the dark clouds, on the other end I say percentage scored in the examination. Now this software has a capability to do a correlation and find the values between these two parameters also. But as a part of human intelligence, you need to understand where to apply correlation and where not to apply. So very, very important and essential part of any of the statistical method is you should be very well aware whether this method can be applied between these two concepts or these two variables or not. So simply putting, again, data processing in the simplest terms can be explained either as measures of central tendency, measures of dispersion, or measures of relation, which we would understand one by one. So as we know, under measures of central tendency, we have mean, mode, and median. So let's first understand mean. In this section, we would understand mean, finding out mean for both grouped data as well as ungrouped data, and for both the ways we would be finding the shortcut method as well. So the first thing we understand is the easiest one and the most commonly done, that is finding mean, arithmetic mean, for a ungrouped data. Now I have four values. What are the four values? 50, 40, 15, and 15. For this, I need to find out the mean. So what I would do is, I am adding all these four values. So I add 50 plus 40 plus 15 plus 15, that is 90 plus 30, 120 divided by 4. So 120 divided by 4 gives me 30. So my mean here is 30. And this is the very simple way of finding the arithmetic mean, the direct method. Now, in this case, the numbers were small, the numbers were easy, so it was easy to find. Now, let's do the same question by the shortcut method. Now, under this shortcut method, I assume any value as an arbitrary value. So, of these numbers, 50, 40, 15, and 15, I assume, let's say, 15 as my arbitrary value. Now, when I take 15 as the arbitrary value, I take the difference of all numbers with 15. So, 40 minus 15, 50 minus 15, 15 minus 15 and 15 minus 15. So, both of those become 0. 40 minus 15 is 25. 50 minus 15 is 35. Now, I add up the differences. So, what I am trying to do here is the D, which is the difference. I add all these differences. It comes to 60. Now, what I do? I have A, which is the arbitrary number, which is what? 15 plus summation of the differences, that is how much? 60 divided by n, which is the total number of items here. So, 1, 2, 3 and 4. So, 60 divided by 4 is how much? 15. So, 15 plus 15 gives me 30. Again, I have the same mean as I calculated with the long method. But here, we applied a shortcut method. And this is the formula for the shortcut method. I take any value as an arbitrary value, A. And then, from that, I take the difference of all the numbers and do a summation for those numbers. And then, divide it by the total number of items. Add the arbitrary value to it. And finally, we have the mean that is ready. So, that this is the way we find the mean for a ungrouped data. Coming on to the grouped data. Now, under the grouped data, what we would do is, again, we would find mean by two methods. One is the general method, which is the long method, as we say, and other is the short method. So, let's first understand the long method. I have the group 0 to 10, 10 to 20, 20 to 30, 30 to 40, 40 to 50. So, I take the mid value of each of those. So, 5, 15, 25, 35 and 45. Now, what I have is the units for each of those. So, for the first, it is 2. So, I calculate the units are 4, 2, 3, 1 and 5. 2, 4, 3, 1 and 5. Now, what I do is I multiply F, the frequency, with the midpoint. So, I have the values as 5 into 2. So, 5 into 2, which is 10, 15 into 4, which is 60, 25 into 3, which is 75, 35 into 1, which is 35, and 45 into 5, which is 225. I add all these. So, summation of fx comes to 405. And what is the summation of frequency? So, summation of frequency comes out to be 15. So, here what we write it as summation fx divided by n, and here n is summation f. So, I can also write it as summation fx divided by summation of f. So, summation fx is 405 and summation of f frequency is 15. I divide 405 by 15 and I have 27 as my mean. So, my mean lies in the center range of 20 to 30 with a mean of 27. Now, this is the way of finding the mean for the grouped data. Now, consider a case where I have a grouped data, but I need to find out the shortcut method. So, what I do is, again, I take the mid values 5, 15, 25, 35 and 45. But here, what is important? The important thing here is, I take any value as arbitrary value and then I find out U, which is each of the number which from which you subtract the arbitrary value divided by the class interval. Now, why I divide here by the class interval? The simple reason being, there is equal class interval. That means each of the differences 0 to 10, 10 to 20, 20 to 30, all of them the difference is 10. If it was not so, my formula would be different, to which we would come in a while. We are first taking a case where the class interval is equal. So, 0 to 10, 10 to 20, 20 to 30 and so on. Now, here I calculate U. U is x minus any arbitrary value. So, I take arbitrary value, the base value as 25 here, and divided by the class interval. So, 0 to 10, 10 to 20, class interval is how much? Class interval is 10. So, here I do 5 minus 25 divided by 10, 15 minus 25 divided by 10, 25 minus 25 divided by 10, 35 minus 25 divided by 10, and 45 minus 25 divided by 10. So, my values are 0, minus 1, minus 2, 1 and 2. Now, what I do is I multiply frequency with this values that I have obtained. So, 2 into minus 2 is minus 4. 4 into minus 1 is minus 4. 3 into 0 is 0. 1 into 1 is 1. And 5 into 2 is 10. I sum up all these, I get 3. Now, I substitute this in the equation here. So, A, which is the arbitrary value, that is 25, plus summation of FU is how much? 3 divided by summation of F. Summation of F is 15. So, 3 divided by 15 into class interval 10. So, that is 30 by 15, so which is 2. So, 25 plus 2 makes it 27. So, my mean value for this group data again comes to 27. Now, this is a method I have applied when the class interval is equal. I repeat again. What would happen if the class interval is not equal? When the class interval is not equal, what would be my u? My u, rather than being the number minus the arbitrary value divided by the class interval, I would keep this formula simple, number minus the arbitrary value that I take into account. And here again, my formula would change. So my formula would be A plus summation of FU divided by summation of F. I would not multiply H again here because here my class intervals are different. So I cannot have 10, 100 as one of the values because each of the class interval, it can be 0 to 9, 9 to 4, 9 to 14, 14 to 28. So the class intervals vary. Now, when you do not have a common class interval, you cannot take class interval into account. And therefore, u would be x minus the arbitrary value. And finally, when you are calculating mean as well, you won't be adding h to it, which is you won't be multiplying h, which is the class interval in this scenario. So, when the unequal intervals are there, you have this formula. So, this is the formula for unequal interval and this is the formula for equal interval. Clear? So, these are the ways under which we can calculate mean for both the grouped data as well as the ungrouped data through the long method as well as the shortcut method that we have understood in this session. To find out median, we calculate the mid value. Now, to find out mid value, first of all, the most important thing is we arrange the data either in an ascending order or in a descending order. So, all the numbers should be arranged in a proper sequence. Then we do a simple formula where we apply n minus 1 by 2 term, that is the value or that is the median. So, let's take two different examples. In the first example, we have the values as 5 different values. So, those are 50, 40, 15, 15 and 5. 5 values, so 5 plus 1 by 2th term, which is the third term. So, third term here would be 1, 2 and 3, which is 15. So, in this case, the median is 15. Now, I take another case. So, this was the case where I had odd number of values. I arrange those in ascending order. And then I find out the n plus 1 by 2th term, which is the third term. And what is the third term? 15. So, my answer becomes 15. Important to note, we don't just stop on the third term. Third term, the value corresponding to it would be the answer. Sometimes the third term, the value is 3, but sometimes the value could be 4 and students get confused there. So, be very, very careful. Don't just stop by finding the third term. Mention what the third term is. Now, what if the data is even? When there is even data, we take n plus 1 by 2th term. So, here 4 values 50, 40, 15 and 15. So, 4 plus 1 by 2th term, which is 2.5th term. That means I take the average of the middle two values. 40 plus 15 divided by 2, that is how much? So, 40 plus 15 divided by 2 is 55 divided by 2, which makes it 27.5. So, this was the median for an ungrouped data where the data is either even or odd. Now, we calculate the median for the grouped data. In the grouped data, first of all, we have the class interval and the frequency. We calculate the cumulative frequency. Finding cumulative frequency, as we know, is very simple. So, in the first case, it remains 2. Now, as we proceed, I add the next value and I have the answer there. So, I add 4 to it and I get 6. Then to 6, I add 3 and I get 9. To 9, I add 1 and I get 10. To 10, I add 5 and I get 15. So I have my cumulative frequency 15. Now, median for a grouped data, the formula is simple. L plus N by 2 minus C divided by F into H. Let's first understand the notations. So L is the lower limit of the median class. Now, how do I calculate the median class? My cumulative frequency is 15. So 15 by 2th term, which is 7.5. So 7.5 would lie where? 7.5 would lie in the range between 6 and 9. So here would be the value where I would have 7.5. And so I take this as the median class. So I know my median class, which is 20 to 30. So L is the lower limit of the median class. So here median class is 20 to 30, lower limit is 20. So I do 20 plus N by 2. N is the cumulative frequency. So 15 by 2 minus the cumulative frequency of the preceding class. So preceding class is 10 to 20 and the cumulative frequency for this is 6. So I do 15 by 2 minus 6 divided by the frequency of the median class. So that is how much? So frequency of the median class is 3. So I divide it by 3 multiplied by class interval, which is 10. So that makes it 20 plus 7.5 minus 6 divided by 3 into 10, which is 15 by 3, which is 5. So 20 plus 5, so this gives me 20 plus 5, which is 25, and 25 becomes my median. I repeat, the notations for this formula are important. L is the lower limit of the median class, which is 20. N is the cumulative frequency. C is the cumulative frequency of the pre-median class, the class before it. F is the frequency of the median class, not the cumulative frequency, but just the frequency of the median class. And H is the class interval. So with this, we calculate median. So that is how we find the median for a ungrouped data and a grouped data. Let's understand mode. So mode is a value that occurs most frequently in the distribution and we call this as mode. Now we have two examples in the ungrouped data. So we would be calculating mode for both the ungrouped and the grouped data today. In the ungrouped data, it is very, very simple. So I have in the first case 5 values, 50, 40, 15, 15 and 5. Now here 15 occurs twice. So 15 is the mode, but there is only one number which is occurring twice and therefore, we call this as a unimodal distribution. So, you have only one mode that occurs twice and therefore, it is unimodal. It can occur thrice, four times, five times, but there is just one value which is showing a repetitive behavior. So, it is unimodal. The next is another case of ungrouped data where I have example as 50, 40, 40, 15, 15. So, I have two values which are occurring twice, 15 and 40. Now, since there are two values which are occurring, both of these values are occurring twice, we call this as bimodal because there would be two peaks that would be witnessed. If there are values which occur three times, same number of values occurring three times, we call this as a trimodal, and there can be multimodal as well. So there is how we understand mode in a ungrouped data. Very, very simple. The maximum number of time you have the repetition for the distribution. It is symbolized as Z or MO. So that is the usual connotation that we use. And this is for the ungrouped data. Coming on to the grouped data, we need to understand the mode carefully. So what we do is, we first find out where we have the class intervals 0 to 10, 10 to 20, 20 to 30, 30 to 40, 40 to 50. And the units are 2, 4, 3, 5 and 1. Okay, the units are 2, 4, 3, 5 and 1. Now, what I do is, I have the formula here. Let's first understand the formula. It is L. L is the lower limit of the modal class. So, modal class I know is which value is repeating maximum number of time? 30 to 40. The values between 30 to 40. So, 30 to 40 becomes my modal class. So, 30 is the lower limit of the modal class plus what I do is frequency of the modal class minus the frequency of the class preceding it. So in this case, the frequency of the modal class is 5, the frequency preceding it is 3 divided by twice the frequency of the modal class, which is 2 into 5 minus the frequency of the preceding class, which is 3, and the frequency of the class following it, which is 1. So minus 3 minus 1 multiplied by h, which is the class interval 10. So here what I have is 30 plus, in the bracket I would have 2 divided by 10 minus 4, which is 6, multiplied by 10. So I would have 30 plus 1 by 3 into 10. So 30 plus 3.33, which is 33.33, is my mode for this grouped data. I repeat again, mode, the formula is very simple. It is L, which is the lower limit, plus the frequency of the modal class minus the frequency of the class preceding it divided by twice the frequency of the modal class minus the frequency of the class preceding it minus the frequency of the class following it multiplied by the class interval. And that is how we calculate mode for a grouped data. Very, very simple, very, very straightforward method where you have to directly apply formula. So this is how we understand mode for both the grouped data as well as the ungrouped data. We have 10 students with different stress level. There are 4 students having a stress level of 8. So what is the distribution? It is unimodal. There is just one peak that is there. Rather than saying that there are 8 students who, there are 4 students who have a stress level of 4, I can say there are 2 peaks that I have. Stress level of 8 that is there with the 4 students, and again stress level of 2, I have 4 students. Previously it were 2. Now let's consider there are 2 more students whose stress level has decreased and their new stress level is 2. So what happens is there are 2 peaks, and these 2 peaks make it a bimodal distribution. However, if there are multiple peaks, there are peaks let's say after every 5 or 10 interval, what would happen is we call it a multimodal distribution. And in case you have all the values coming on a single line, we say it is a rectangular distribution. So understanding the terms is very, very important. Unimodal means just one peak. Bimodal means there are 2 peaks. Multimodal means there are many peaks. And rectangular distribution means all the peaks are at the same level, and therefore you have a uniform frequency that is taken for all of those. Now, once we understand this distribution, the next important thing that we try to understand or assimilate is the types of distribution. The distribution can be symmetrical or skewed. When I say symmetrical distribution, it is as per a normal probability curve. The best way to understand a normal probability curve is, I have a normal probability curve. Consider this as a figure drawn on a paper, and when I fold it, now when I'm trying to fold it, this perfectly overlaps. When I say this perfectly overlaps, this means this is a symmetrical distribution. However, in case of skewed distribution, the distribution is not symmetrical. That means it would not perfectly overlap. And when I say it would not perfectly overlap, what does it stand for? It stands for a skewed distribution. Skewed word comes from a French word which means skew, and that Q basically, and that Q is the direction of the tail in which the line is going, or in which the Q is going, is what is skew. To understand the direction of skew is very, very important. Commonly students do a lot of mistake understanding this. The side with a fewer value, or the tail I would say, is the direction of the skew. So when I say positively skewed, that means it is towards the right, because you have the direction of the tail which is here. So direction of the tail is here, and that's how we understand the skewness. On the other hand, when I say negatively skewed, the direction of the tail changes, and it is a left skew or a negative skew that is seen. So a distribution which is skewed to the left would be a negative skewed distribution. A distribution skewed to the right would be a positive skewed distribution. So we understand the difference between symmetrical distribution and skewed distribution. This skewed distribution is governed by the direction of the tail or fewer number of values. So if the skew is towards the right, I say it's positively skewed, the peak would be on the left. If I say the skewed is, this is skewed to the left, that means it is negatively skewed and the peak would be towards the right. Very, very clear. Coming on to the next effect, which is the floor effect versus a ceiling effect. When I say floor effect, most of the values pile up towards the lower end. So when I say most of the values pile up towards the lower end, the distribution is skewed towards the right. A good example is, let's say a family cannot have less than zero number of children, or fewer than zero number of children cannot be possible. So what it happens is, it is not possible to have any score which is lower than a given score, and that is what is a floor effect. On the other hand, when I say ceiling effect, it's not possible to have a score higher than a given score, and that's what is a ceiling effect. So floor on the base, not below that is possible. Ceiling, the roof, not above that is possible. So you are in a room of statistics with a floor and a ceiling. No value below it would be the floor effect. No value possible above it would be the ceiling effect. The next important term that we understand is kurtosis. Now, kurtosis is the shape of the distribution. When I say a normal probability curve, it's a symmetrical distribution. Kurtosis again is symmetrical, but it is either flattened or steepened. So depending upon the curvature, so if it is flatter, we say it is platykurtosis. If it is normal, we say it's mesokurtosis. And if it is peaked, we say it is leptokurtosis. So distributions with usually a flatter curve, I would say, have fewer scores towards the tail as compared to a normal distribution curve that is there. And along with that, sometimes we do have problems where there are misleading graphs that are drawn. Now, what does this misleading graph stand for? Misleading graph means sometimes the value, the intervals are not proper. So let's say one interval is 0 to 5, the next interval is 5 to 15, the third interval is 15 to 20. So if I vary the range of the intervals that I am taking, definitely my graph would be misleading, a very incorrect method in statistics. And the next is exaggeration of the proportions. So if I exaggerate the proportion, let's say I draw 0 to 1 at this scale, and then I draw 0 to 5 at this scale. So what I am doing is, I am doing an exaggeration. It should be just 5 times of this. So if this is this, it should be 5 times of this. But when I am increasing the height to any quantity, it becomes an exaggeration and a disproportion. So that becomes a kind of misleading graph. So it's very important to note, under statistics, we cannot go for uneven intervals that are there that would lead to misleading graphs. We cannot go for exaggeration of proportions that would again lead to a misleading graph. So this was a very fundamental introduction to statistics. We would be covering many interesting lectures in statistics. Stay tuned. Have a wonderful day. 35 minus 25 divided by 10 giving me 1, and 45 minus 25 divided by 10 giving me 2. So I have minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1 and 2. Very, very simple. So whenever you take values like this, this would be the answer that would come. So a very simple way to calculate this. Now what I do is, I multiply this with frequency. So it becomes minus 4, minus 4, 0, 1 and 10. I sum up these values, so it is minus 8 and 11. So minus 8 plus 11 gives me how much? Minus 8 plus 11 gives me 3. So my FU is 3. So sum of the FU is how much? The sum of the FU is 3. Now what is the simple way and a shortcut way to find mean in this case? The simple and the shortcut way to find the mean in this case is I have the base value which is 25. 25 plus the summation of FU. Summation of FU is how much? Summation of FU is 3. Divided by n. N is how much? N is the total frequency, the sum of the frequency which was 15 multiplied by 10. So it is 25 plus 30 divided by 15, and that is 25 plus 2, which again comes out to be 27. But this is a shortcut way of finding the mean. So we have first of all calculated mean, and this is required for finding the mean deviation in a grouped data. And finding the mean, we have two methods. One is the direct method where we multiply fx and divide it by f. And this gives me the summation of fx divided by summation of f gives me the mean. In the other case, we calculated u. We multiplied f, that is the frequency, with u. And then we sum this value. So it gives me 3 here. Now what I do is I take the base value plus summation of fu divided by the total summation of f multiplied by the class interval. So that is 25, which was the base value we took, plus summation of fu, which came out to be how much? Which came out to be 3, divided by the summation of frequency, which is, we already know, 15, multiplied by the class interval. In this case, 0 to 10, 10 to 20, so the class interval is 10. So I multiplied by 10. I solve this, again I have 27. So in either case, I have a mean of 27. Now, when we have calculated the mean, let us find out the mean deviation. So here, we already know these values. I can fill it directly here. So I have the mid values that I already know, the u values, which is 0, minus 1, minus 2, 1 and 2. So the fu becomes minus 4, minus 4, 0, 1 and 10. Summation of this becomes 3, and then I have f multiplied by x minus x bar, absolute value of x minus x bar. So here what is x? 5. And x bar is how much? X bar is 27. That is the mean. Mean we already calculated through both the methods, and the answer comes out to be 27. So what I do is I multiply frequency, which is 2, multiplied by the absolute value of 5 minus 27. The next case would be 4, which is the frequency, multiplied by x, which is how much? 15 minus 27. Then I have the frequency is 3 multiplied by 25 minus absolute value of 25 minus 27. 1 multiplied by 35 minus 27. And then 5 multiplied by 45 minus 27. Now, when I solve these values, what are the values that come up here? The values that come up is 2 into 22. So we have 2 multiplied by 22 as the first value. So 2 into 22. The next case would be 4 into 4 multiplied by 12. Then we have 3 multiplied by 2. 1 multiplied by 8 and 5 multiplied by, we have 18 here. Okay, now I solve this. So my values become 44 plus 4 into 12, which is 24, and 48. Then I have 6, then I have 8, and then the last value is 5 into 18, which is 90. So I add up all these values. Now my values would be summation of 44 plus 48 plus 8 plus 6 plus 90 divided by n, and n is how much? The sum of the total frequency, which is 15, 2 plus 4 plus 3 plus 1 plus 5, and that is 15. So I divide this value by 15. Now I can simply have the solution for this. So this gives me 50 plus 90, 140. 140 plus 48 is 188, and 188 plus 8 is 196. Okay, so 196 divided by 15 would be my mean deviation. So that is how we calculate mean deviation for a grouped data. We first of all calculated the mean. We already understood how we calculate the mean through the long method as well as the shortcut method. Now, once we have the mean, what we do is each value minus the mean value, and we take an absolute value of this and we multiply it by with the frequency, which is f, and then we solve it, we sum it. So it is summation of these values divided by the n, which is the total of all frequency, which is 15 here, and then we solve this question. And this is how we do a very, very simple way under which the questions related to mean deviation can be resolved. Now again, if you want to move forward, if I have 150, that means it is 10 times, 180, that means it is 12 times, 195, which is 13 times, so the value would be 13 point, I would have 10 carryover, so 13.0, and then you would have 6, so you would have 13.06 as the answer here, and this is how we calculate the mean deviation of a grouped data. Understanding standard deviation for an ungrouped data. We would understand both the long method and the short method for calculating the standard deviation for an ungrouped data. So let's first talk about the short method. Here what we have is 5 numbers, 1, 3, 5, 7 and 9, very, very simple numbers. So what I do is I take out the mean. So 1 plus 3 plus 5 plus 7 plus 9 divided by the total number of items. So 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 items. So I divide it by 5. That gives me 25 divided by 5, which is 5. Now 5 is the mean that I have. I would calculate x as the number minus the mean, which is 1 minus 5, 3 minus 5, 5 minus 5, 7 minus 5 and 9 minus 5. So what are the values? Minus 4, minus 2, 0, 2 and 4. Now what I do is I take the square of these numbers. So it is 16, 4, 0, 4 and 16. So when I am taking a square, the negative values convert into 4, positive. Minus 4 into minus 4 would give me plus 16. And therefore I take the values here, all the values turn out to be positive. So it is 16 plus 4 plus 0 plus 4 plus 16, which gives me 40. Now, this is the summation of the x square that we have calculated. For a standard deviation, what we do is the summation of x square, which is 40, divided by the number of items, 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 items. So I divide 40 by 5, which gives me how much? 8, and I take the under root of 8, that gives me approximately 2.83. Now this 2.83 is what? 2.83 is my standard deviation. So when the observations for different places or periods are explained in different units or measurement and those are to be compared, then what we do? We use coefficient of variation. So coefficient of variation, as we said, is a relative measure. However, standard deviation is an absolute measure of dispersion. So how do we calculate the coefficient of variation here? Again, very simple. Coefficient of variation is standard deviation divided by the mean value into 100. We know the standard deviation is 2.83 divided by 5 into 100. That gives me somewhere around 56. So I have 56% as the coefficient of variation. So coefficient of variation, even for the grouped data, can be calculated using the same formula, which is standard deviation divided by mean into 100. And standard deviation, to put very simply, is the positive square root, since I am taking a square of the x minus x bar. Therefore, it is the positive square root. Now, the positive square root of the average of squares of the deviations about the mean. So, about the mean, which was here 5, I have taken, since here in this value 5 becomes the mean itself, it is the middle value and mean as well as the median here. Now, this 5 is the mean. And I am taking the deviations around this 5. And therefore, it is the positive square root of the average of squares of deviation. And therefore, greater weightage is given to higher deviations which are around the mean in case of standard deviation, as we said. Now, this was the first method. What is the second method? Under the second method, what we do is, I have the numbers. I simply take the square of the numbers. Square of the numbers is 1 square 1, 3 square 9, 5 square 25, 7 square 49 and 9 square 81. And then I add up all these numbers which gives me 165. So standard deviation simply put is 165 divided by the number of items 5 minus the sum of the x. So sum of the x is how much? Sum of the x here is 25, which is 1 plus 3 plus 5 plus 7 plus 9. I add up all these numbers and this is 25. So that is 25 divided by the number of items 5 and the square of it. So how do I calculate again? It is under root of 165 divided by 5 minus 5 into 5. I take 5 as the root. So 5 as the LCM. So 5. And then you would have 165 into 25 multiplied by 5. And this would give me again 40 divided by 5. So 40 divided by 5 is again 8. So square root of 8 again. So that gives me 2.83 as the answer again. Now both the long data and the short data, the long method and the short method can be used for finding out the standard deviation. Depends on you. Which method you are more comfortable with and what are the numbers like. If the numbers are easy to go, as in this case, you can even use the longer method as we have recommended, or if not, you can go for the short method as well. And this is the standard deviation method for the ungrouped data only. Now let's understand the standard deviation for a grouped data. To understand standard deviation for a grouped data, we have three methods: the long method, short method and a quick method. So we would understand all of these three methods one by one. To begin with, let's take out the first and the very basic method for understanding the standard deviation of the grouped data. Now here, this is also known as the long method. What I do is, I have the classes and I have the frequency. So first of all, what I do is, I calculate the midpoint. The midpoint is 5, 15, 25, 35 and 45, and I have the frequencies for these. Now what I do is, I multiply the frequency with the midpoint. So here I multiply the frequency and the midpoint, that is 5 into 2, 15 into 4, 25 into 3, 35 into 1, 45 into 5, and these are 10, 60, 75, 35 and 225. I sum these up as 405. So this is summation of fx. Now what I do is, I also multiply the frequency with x square. Now what are the values here? Frequency is 2 multiplied by 5 square, 4 multiplied by 15 square, 3 multiplied by 25 square, 1 multiplied by 35 square and 5 multiplied by 45 square, and then I have 2 into 25 and so on. So I find out all these values, which is 4 into 225, and then I have 3 into 625, I have 1 into 1225 and 5 into 2025, and I sum all these values. When I add up all these values, this gives me 1, 4, 1, 7 and 5. So this is my fx square. Now how do I calculate the standard deviation? I have both the required values that I need and also the sum of the units. Now the sum of the units here is the sum of the frequency. So how much it is? 2 plus 4 plus 3 plus 1 plus 5, that gives me 15. Now I have all the data I require. So my standard deviation would be root of summation of fx square. Summation of fx square we have calculated is 14175. Divided by 15 minus summation of fx divided by n the whole square. So summation of fx was 405. 405 divided by 15 into 405 divided by 15. And this can, I can write it as 27 multiplied by 27. And when I solve this, it is under root of 14175 divided by 15 minus 729, which gives me under root of 216. I take the LCM, I solve it further. It gives me LCM under root of 216. And this gives me approximately 14.69. So my standard deviation for this value by the long method is 14.69. This long method, I explain again. First of all, I have the frequency. I take out the midpoint from the class intervals that are given. I multiply frequency into the midpoint and sum those, add those up. And then I multiply frequency by the square of the midpoints. And then I add those up. And then I apply it in the simple formula for standard deviation, which is root of summation fx square divided by n minus summation fx by n the whole square. And then I substitute the value, solve it. It gives me 14.69. And this is the long method. Now, before doing the short method, let's first understand the calculation of the mean. How do we calculate mean in case of a grouped data? So, to repeat again, to calculate mean for a grouped data, I take the mid values. Now, when I take the mid values, what I do is there are two methods of it. Firstly is I multiply fx. So, it is 5 into 2, 15 into 4. 25 into 3, 35 into 1 and 45 into 5, and I add those values, which gives me 405, and then I also sum up the frequencies, that gives me 15. So one way of calculating the mean is summation of fx divided by summation of f, which gives me how much? This gives me 405 divided by 15, which is 27. So my mean here comes out to be 27. But I also have a shortcut method of calculating the mean. What is the shortcut method? Among all the midpoints, I can choose any value as per my convenience as the base value. So I take 25 in this example. So when I take 25 as the base value, I calculate u, which is each value minus the base value divided by the class interval, which is 10 in this case. So it is 15 minus 25 divided by 10, 5 minus 25 divided by 10, 25 minus 25 divided by 10, 35 minus 25 divided by 10, and 45 minus 25 divided by 10. So it is 0 minus 1 minus 2, 1 and 2. Now I multiply frequency and u, which is frequency is how much? 2, and this is minus 2. So it is minus 4, minus 4, 0, 1 and 10. I do a summation of fu, which is 11. 11 minus 8 is 3. So it is 3. Now, what is the formula? The formula is the of calculating the mean through the shortcut method is the base value minus summation of fu divided by summation of f multiplied by the class interval. So base here is 25 plus summation of fu is 3 divided by summation of frequency 15 multiplied by the class interval 10. So it is 25 plus 30 by 15, which is 2. So 25 plus 2, which gives me 27, and 27 is the mean. So what we have done is we have calculated mean both through the long method and the short method. Now let's understand finding the standard deviation of a grouped method, grouped data through a short method. Through the short method, again, I have the midpoint as 15, 5, 15, 25, 35, and 45. Now what I do is I have x is equal to x minus x bar. I already know the mean, which we have calculated in the last slide. So my mean is 27 here. So what is the value of x here? My value for the x here would be 5 minus 27, 15 minus 27, 25 minus 27, 35 minus 27 and 45 minus 27. So this gives me 22, 12. 2 minus 22 minus 20 minus 22 minus 12 minus 2, then we have 8 and 18. Now what I do is frequency multiplied by this value square. So 2 into minus 22 square, 4 into minus 12 square, I have 3 into minus 2 square, 1 into 8 square, and 5 into 18 square. Now, since I have the values for the squares here, I just solve these and sum these. So, this would be 3240. Now, I have the value here 3240. So, 3240, which is the sum of the frequency multiplied by the square of the difference between the each value and the mean value, which we have calculated here. And this is 3240 divided by n, which is the total frequency, which is 15. So 3240 divided by 15 and under root of it. How do I calculate again? So 3240 divided by 15 would give me 216. So square root of 216 again gives me how much? 14.69. So 14.69 is my answer. So we have understood the long method. We have understood the short method for calculating the standard deviation, and we have also understood how we calculate the mean. Coming on now is the shortcut method for finding out the standard deviation. Now, this shortcut method is a really, really interesting method. How we solve this is further interesting. First of all, I'll calculate the mid value. So, mid value is 5. 15, 25, 35 and 45 again. The sum of the F is 15. I add up 2 plus 4 plus 3 plus 1 plus 5. That gives me 15. Now, what I calculate is U. Now, this U is required for me even to calculate the mean, as we know. Now, how do we calculate U? I can take any of these mid values, whatever I assume, as a base value. So, I take 25 as a base value here. So, from each value, I'll subtract 25 and divide it by 10. So, I'll calculate U. Very, very simple. So, what I do is 5 minus 25 divided by 10, 15 minus 25 divided by 10, 25 minus 25 divided by 10, 35 minus 25 divided by 10, and 45 minus 25 divided by 10. So it gives me 0, minus 1, minus 2, 1, and 2. These are my U. Now, I multiply U with the frequency. So it gives me minus 4, minus 4, 3 into 0 is 0, 1 into 1 is 1, and 5 into 2 is 10. I have FU. Now with this FU, I calculate, I sum this FU. So summation of FU gives me 11 minus 8, which is 3. So I have 3 here. Now, I have the FU value. What I need to do first of all is calculate the mean. Now, mean, as we already know, is how much? The mean calculation is very, very simple. Mean, I can say the base value, which is 25, plus this summation of FU divided by 15, which is the summation of F multiplied by the class interval. So, this gives me 27. So, I can also calculate mean through this shortcut method. But since I have to do standard deviation, I'll keep myself to standard deviation here and understand the shortcut. So, I have calculated FU. Now, the next thing I do is I calculate FU square. So, U square is minus 2 square and multiplied by F, which is 2, 4 multiplied by minus 1 square, 3 multiplied by 0 square, 1 multiplied by 1 square, and then 5 multiplied by 2 square. So, I have 4 into 2, which is 8. Then I have 4, 0, 1 and 4 into 2, which is 20. I sum up all these values. This gives me 33. So, my summation of FU square is 33. Now, I replace this in the formula of standard deviation. So, standard deviation is equal to class interval, which is 10, multiplied by the root of summation of FU square, which is how much? 33 divided by the summation of frequency, which is 15, minus the summation of FU divided by N the whole square. So, FU here is 3 divided by 5, divided by 15, which is the summation of frequency the whole square. Okay. So, this is 10 multiplied by the under root of 33 by 15 minus 3 by 15 into 3 by 15. Now, when I solve this, I have when I expand this and I solve this, it is 495 divided by 15 into 15 minus 9. So I take 15 into 15 as the LCM. So here I multiply 33 into 15. So that gives me 495 minus 3 into 3, which is 9. And then I take the under root of it again. So this gives me root of 486 divided by 225. And this value I would multiply with what? I would multiply with 10. So it would be 10 into 1.469, which gives me 14.69, and this is the same answer as we calculate with the normal standard deviation method. So this is standard deviation method. This quick trick is helpful to understand the solution, because the calculations do not go into extreme complexities. The calculations remain relatively easier to understand, and therefore standard deviation can be calculated through this quick method as well. So these are the methods to calculate the standard deviation. Coming on next is the coefficient of variation. Now, since we have already calculated the standard deviation as 14.69 in this case, and the mean we calculated was 27, for coefficient of variation, we simply do what? We simply divide 14.6 by 27 multiplied by 100, and this would give me the coefficient of variation. Coefficient of variation is important because it is a relative measure of dispersion. However, standard deviation is an absolute measure of dispersion, and this is the main difference between the two. And since this coefficient of variation is a relative measure of dispersion, this can be used across any of the two measurements that are there. And I need to understand nature of relationship between two things or two sets of data, we apply correlation. Very simple way to explain this is the amount of dark clouds and the probability of rain. So I'm trying to have a correlation between dark clouds and the rain, but I cannot have a correlation between, let's say, the clouds and the marks you obtained in the examination, which can be statistically found out by any statistical software, but practically there is no correlation. Now what we need to understand here is, when we are following the correlation, we understand that there is interdependence or relationship that exists between two sets of values, and how we understand this relationship. There can be three ways under which we can understand this relationship. The first is, as the input increases, the output would increase. The second is, when the input increases, the output can decrease. And the third is, it is independent of the input. The output is independent of the input. So in the first case, when I say input increases and output increases, we say it is a positive correlation. When I say my input increases but my output is decreasing, it is a negative correlation. And when I say the output is independent of the input, there is no correlation. So those are the three things that you need to understand. Now, correlation is expressed from minus 1 to 0 to plus 1. Any value which is 0 indicates there is no relationship, no correlation between the two variables. A value of plus 1 indicates a perfect positive correlation. So you would have a straight line graph that can be represented. A value of minus 1 represents a perfect negative correlation, a straight line declining. So if my input is increasing, the output would decrease. But it is a perfectly negative correlation. And any value between 0 to 1 would be a correlation value, but the values less than 0.5 towards 0 would be weak correlation, and values between 0.5 to 1 would be strong correlation. Similarly, values between 0 to minus 0.5 would be weak correlation, and minus 0.5 to minus 1 would be strong correlation. So let me just cite an example, 0.8. So 0.8 is a strong positive correlation. However, if I say minus 0.7, this is a strong negative correlation since it's a minus sign. So that's a broad idea to understand correlation. Now, again, important to understand, when I plot the correlation, all of the values could be closer to the central line. If the values are closer to the center, I say it is a strong correlation. However, if the values are much more dispersed from the center, so this is my center line, and the values are more dispersed, I say this is moderately correlated. However, in this case where I have the straight line here and the values are very, very close to the straight line, I say it is a strong correlation. Also, when there is more scattering of data, the data is more scattered, the correlation becomes weak. If the data is more clustered, it would have a stronger correlation that would exist. So how do we find out the correlation? There are numerous methods to find out correlation. In this section, we would understand one very simple method, and that is Spearman's rank correlation. Named as Spearman's rank correlation, devised by Spearman, and the idea is to find the correlation by ranking. So how do we do that? I have two sets of numbers which are there. First, we need to rank the numbers. And when we are ranking the numbers, the highest value would be ranked the highest. So I have the values for X and Y. So first take X. The values are 50, 40, 15, 18 and 20. So 15 becomes the first rank. 18 becomes the second rank, 20 becomes the third rank, 40 becomes the fifth rank, and 50 becomes the fifth rank. Okay. Now, the other set of values are 15, 50, 8, 26, 45 and 14. Here, 14 becomes the first rank, 15 becomes the second rank, 26 becomes the third rank, 45 becomes the fourth rank and 58 becomes the fifth rank. Now, I have written the ranks. What I do is, I take the difference of the ranks. So, in this case, it is 5 minus 2, which is 3, then 4 minus 5 minus 1, 1 minus 3, which is minus 2, 2 minus 4, which is minus 2, and 3 minus 1, which is 2. I square the differences. So it is 9, 1, 4, 4, 4. So 4, 4, 4, 12, 12 plus 1, 13, 13 plus 9 is 22. So I have summation of d squared, the difference between the two sets of rank, the square of those and the summation of those turns out to be 22. Now I apply the formula. The Spearman's rank order correlation is represented by the sign rho. Now this rho or the correlation is 1 minus what? 6 multiplied by 22, which is the summation of d square, summation of the difference squares, and n is the number of pairs. So how many number of pairs? 5. So 5 into 5 square minus 1. So I have 1 minus 6 into 22 divided by 5 into 24, and I solve this and I get the value for the rho, which is my correlation here. Now, as we know, the values of the correlation would lie always between plus 1 to minus 1, and based on what we have understood in the introduction, we would have the ranking that would be obtained. Also, the method is very, very applicable, because what we are doing is we are not taking the exact values. We are just ranking the values and finding the difference between the ranks. Once we find the difference between the rank, we square those differences and multiply it by 6 in the numerator. And then in the denominator, we have number of units multiplied by square of the number of units minus 1. And this whole value is subtracted from 1. And that's what we have as the rank correlation given by Spearman. Very, very simple, very, very direct method of finding out the relationship between two sets of data. So set X and set Y, we understand the relationship between the two sets of data here. Thank you.